We'll wait to the end on the question. For the demo lecture, I'll make it very quick, because here it's assuming you haven't read the material, so I'll just do it on a conceptual basis. In level two, there's two parts to the demo lecture. One, it's more on quantitative, giving you a perspective on what you see in level two, what you need to do. And then after this, there'll be three short multiple choice questions, which is more from level one level. Okay. So quick background, we're doing binomial tree. You see this in level two. Normally for derivative, there are three or four main ways to price them. Right? One is analytical, so just pure formula. You got the Black-Scholes. And then you have Monte Carlo, pretty much run, set up the system and run it many, many times and see what the average is. And the last is binomial tree. It's used very often. It's very computer programming friendly. So it's easy to program it to do many things, which others cannot do. So it's very, very to use. Most people, including I, use this for our pricing and our simulations and work. So here, there's only three steps for binomial tree. It's pretty easy. Once you set it up, it runs perfectly. But in case, so let's do a stock. So this is a stock, $30 now, the stock price going into the future. I have an option on this stock. Okay, so let's say I have something, let's say a 32 call. So the price of this call is on the right, maybe $1. So as my stock move up and down, the call price move up and down with it. The problem is it's not symmetric, right? So it's not proportional, it's somewhat proportional, but it's not direct. So what I need to do is, what I need to know is how much is it today, right? So there's only three steps. The first would be, this is when the stock expire. So the first step would be, ignore the option first. What is the stock price at the end of the period when the stock expires, when the option expires? So that's the first step. So here, this is where the tree come in. Here, this is the first part of the tree. This is purely on the stock. Just looking at if I'm standing here today, I know the stock price is 30. I need the option price today, but I don't have it. So the first step is I check the price at to the end of the expiry and see what it can be, possibly. So that's the first step. The second would be, given the result of step one, so I found all the possible stock price here. I check all the possible option price given the stock price. So that's the second step. And then a third step would be, given I know step two, just bring all the possible option price back to today, and I get the price today, right? So the binomial tree pretty much do that process. So in the first step, if you look at textbooks, you get this tree. This is really step one, just what the stock price will be. Given $30 today, it can be 32, 28, if it go down, 34, 30, 26, and so on. This is the price of potential stock price at the end. Second step would be the option value at the expiry. So if it's 32 call, this will be $2, 0 and 0. So this is step two, my option price in blue given my stock price in red. And the step three will be just discounting these back to today, and that is your option price today, right? So here the good part is when you have exotic options, you might have an indirect payoff. You can have a leverage, you can have a accumulator type. So on those, you can adjust here for your payoff easily. If you have exotic options, for example, easier one might be American type, where you can get exercise tier. You might have knock in, knock out. So if it hits 32, it disappears. You can all build into each knot as you construct it. Okay, so this is one good part of using the binomial tree. It's simple to build in things for all your exotics. Okay, so in level 2, you'll be doing all the calculations, starting from here, physically calculating it to here, do all calculations back. This is just conceptually how they'll work. Okay, so this is for binomial tree. This, normally I'll let you time to read, but here, since time-wise we're pretty close, we'll just go through this. I'll give you the answer and highlight things that you should consider. In class or here, I would physically highlight the important words that you should be aware of or think about. In real life, as you get more practice, you read it and deep down, subconsciously, you know a red flag here, a red flag there, so you would pick up as you select the answers, which one is more appropriate. So here we have a client. She has approached. This is our character, right? And then we have the client wanted to buy shares of a real estate development firm. So here it would be risky. In the curriculum, it mentions a particular characteristics of real estate. It's illiquid. It's hard to price. There's no fixed index or hard to value because each one is unique. So this is a higher risk than even a normal AI. This is the client. She's a retired, so another flag. School teacher, meaning low income. Late husband. So everything points to, if you have, normally you would ask a client at least every year how she's doing, how much money you have to make sure you know they're doing okay. So there's normally a policy statement of what they can invest in. Given all these things, a retired school teacher, female, late husband, living on an insurance policy, this is pretty much a low risk investor, right? So this one sentence has flags in it showing you the risk level of the client. And then she wants to buy this high risk firm with speculative projects. So we have a conflict of a low risk client wanting to buy high risk investment. So here, this is one way to ask is, do you take the order or do you not? Another way this can be asked is consistent with the standards. Another way can be asked is, what standard? So it might be saying it's consistent with standard 2 and 4, consistent with standard 2 but not 4, etc. So that's another way to look at these type of questions. But for here, so do we accept the order? Normally we would say it's a low risk investor, high risk investment, we shouldn't let her buy it, right? But here, the client approach us, so it makes a different story. Logically, we should not recommend this investment period, right? It's not suitable. So under the standard, you have to suggest or recommend suitable investment. Otherwise, it's not very good, right? But here, it's different. The client approach us, right? It's not we approach them. So it makes the story a little bit different. So here, the answer would be C. So here we accept the order, so we can accept because the client approached us, but here we have her sign a disclaimer versus we accept the order, but we discuss and explain to her the risk of the investment. So you can think, well, A and C looks very similar, but here, C is really making the client understand before they decide. If they decide to go ahead, they can. A, it's really not a very responsible thing to do. right? It's really a selfish thing where, oh, she signed the form, she lost, it's not my problem. You can say it's not legal, it's not illegal, it's okay, it's not doing nothing wrong, but compared to two, you got C is a better answer, right? And then B, not acceptable, it's incorrect here because the client approached us. D is not, it's okay in the first part, or not acceptable order, but here explain to her the training and investment experience doesn't make much sense. Right? So here this is ticking, deciding between not accepting first. If you thought, oh, this is unsuitable, you tick B, you got the wrong answer. But here it's the client approach us, and then you have to decide which one is a good reason. So this one is easier, you got a C as a better reason. So many times it's not direct, but you have to compare between which one is better answer, more suitable. There's really no right answer sometimes. This one I'll let you do. This is pretty easy, so I'll let you see. Let me see. A is the right answer. I'll let you do that yourself. So this is one where it's more of a level one calculation, quantitative. It's not really calculation, but it tests you on how well you know your material. Okay. So here we have a fund manager. He's an arbitrage. So taking minimum risk, taking a spread between the positions. So here you're given this information. So we have, so we have a hump in our U curve. Okay, so given this, right now he doesn't have much chance of making profit. But given his expectation, so he's saying, I think it would remain the same in the next 12 months. Okay, so how does he make money? Effectively, this is what's now. 12 months later, same shape. But what has changed? The 7-year, the 7-year debt becomes a 6-year, right? So everything here, if you buy a 6-year paper, next year becomes a 5-year paper, and so on, right? So he is trying to arbitrage the maturing of the paper between the 1 year. So here you have to figure out which one can make him money, right? So here, given no change in U curve, we have if interest rate go up, the price go down. Interest rate go down, price go up. So that's our basic bond math, right? Interest rate go up, bond price go down. So I'll use this, I'll write it down. I don't have to think of it every time. So now I check. How can he make money? So I just look, a long position in 6-year treasury. So he buys one here, yield is 3.75. He bought it. Next year it becomes a 5-year paper. And the interest rate for a 5-year paper is 4, right? The interest rate go up, the price go down, right? He's long the paper, he bought it at a higher price. Next year the price went down. So this is a losing position. Are we okay? So you can do the same logic throughout. He's short a 4. So next year it's a 3-year paper. Here it doesn't give a 3-year. Assuming given the normal shape, it should be lower. So rates go lower, the price go up. Here it's making money. Wait, the price go up, but he's short. So he's actually losing money here. Are we okay? So you do the same logic throughout and check each one. I think at the end, B is the right answer. Okay, this is the one where it makes money in both position. So he's long a 7. A year later, it becomes a 6-year paper. The rates have decreased. The price had went up. He's long, so he makes money here. He's short a 6. Next year, the yield go up. The price went down. but he's short, so he also makes money here. So here it's make money in both position, versus you can check the other two. I think they both lose money in both sides. Okay, so this is just one check to see how fast you can do this or understand the question. Okay.